Good afternoon, everybody. I, without a nameplate, am Barry Friedman. I'm the vice dean, and I convene these fora every week. We started doing this a few weeks ago. We've had a great crowd. We usually organize the room a different way, and we did it this way only because we had a screen, and so we, if you were going to see the screen, this was the way that we were going to organize it. We organize all of the fora so that there's lots of time for conversation, and we're going to particularly make sure that that's the case today because we know that there are lots of things that folks want to say. I thank you very much for coming. I am going to do, though, one task I think I'm going to perform until the end of the forum, which is to introduce our moderator, which is Professor Amy Adler to my right. Professor Adler is a scholar of art law and the First Amendment. She looks at the First Amendment from a lot of perspectives, including critical ones, and we thought she'd be an ideal moderator for today's program. So, Amy.
Oh, okay, well, thank you. Thanks, Barry, for putting on this debate and including me. My job as moderator is basically to make sure that as many of you as possible get a chance to speak today. But I do want to say a quick word of thanks to Professor Yoshino and Professor Ellis for their generosity in sharing their considerable expertise with us today. And I also wanted to say a word of thanks to you, the student body, the people here, the people who pushed for this debate to happen. And I admire your commitment to continuing to pursue the important issues raised by Dr. Thio's appointment. So thank you very much. The rules of the debate are simple. Each Professor Yoshino and Professor Ellis will each get 7 minutes to introduce him or herself and make an opening statement, and then each gets 3 minutes of rebuttal. And after that, the floor is open to all of you. So we're gonna begin with Professor Deb Ellis.
I'm going to quickly begin by introducing myself. I'm Assistant Dean for Public Interest Law here. I graduated from NYU Law School in 1982, so I've been a member of this community for a long time. I taught lawyering here beginning in 2001, and before that I taught sex discrimination law here as an adjunct. After I graduated from NYU Law, I had the privilege to go to Montgomery, Alabama to clerk. I now oversee our clerkship efforts. And we tell clerkships for many good reasons. And my clerkship taught me many good things. But most of all, it exposed me and enabled me to learn from a courageous man. His name was Judge Frank M. Johnson, Jr. He was a famous civil rights judge, and near the end of his career, he actually overturned Georgia's sodomy law in Bowers versus Hardwick in 1985. His decision, of course, was overturned by the United States Supreme Court in 1986 and only overturned then, or his decision was only upheld in Lawrence versus Texas in 2003. But from Judge Frank Johnson, I learned courage, and I'm thinking of him today. After my clerkship, I did a wide variety of civil rights work, representing women, people of color, LGBT clients, and religious minorities at the Southern Poverty Law Center, the local ACLU of New Jersey, and the National ACLU, and the Now Legal Defense Fund. I'm a strong believer in both civil rights and free speech. I've also represented the Ku Klux Klan. In 1993, I spoke here at NYU for a Hayes reunion. And at that Hayes reunion, chaired by Professor Norman Dorson, who just walked in, I spoke about a case where I represented Lois Robinson, a woman welder, in a predominantly male shipyard in Jacksonville, Florida. In that case, we argued that Title VII's anti-discrimination provisions enabled, forced Jacksonville Shipyard to take down the pornography that was in the workplace and that Lois Robinson had to face every day. And the presentation I did at NYU 16 years ago was turned into a book chapter called Speech and Equality, Do We Really Have to Choose? So I thank Professor Yoshino for inviting me to do this today, and I'm glad to be here today again, thinking with all of us about how we as an institution can balance speech inequality. I want to begin by saying that I believe we made a mistake in hiring Professor Thio, and the proper course would have been to acknowledge that mistake and rescind her appointment. As you know, I do not speak for the law school, but I personally feel very upset that we chose to hire her out of the hundreds of qualified professors who would love to teach at NYU. By hiring her, I believe that we privileged academic freedom over our students' right to learn in a non-discriminatory environment. I could spend my whole time arguing that Professor Thio is not competent to teach human rights and that academic freedom should not protect her conduct as a member of the Singapore Parliament. However, I want to spend my initial time here today speaking about the future. I want to propose that NYU can balance our values of academic freedom with our values of equality. I am strongly committed to free speech, as I said. I would represent Professor Thio if New York City denied her a permit to march down Sullivan Street. I believe so strongly, as you know, in free speech that I have represented the Ku Klux Klan. And why do I believe so strongly in free speech? Under our constitutional system, we believe that the remedy for hateful speech, for bad speech, for extreme speech is more speech. We believe in the marketplace of ideas. We believe that we suppress speech at our peril, for our speech could be the next speech to be suppressed. But I want to remind everyone that the First Amendment does not apply to NYU Law School. Now, you first-year students may not have learned that yet. I hope the 2Ls and 3Ls have. But the Constitution only applies to government action. And so we see here, it says Congress shall make no law. That's been extended to states and local and localities, but has not been extended to private institutions. So, moreover, the constitutional remedy of more speech has real practical limitations at NYU or at any school, because it does not apply with equal force in a classroom where a professor grades students in part on their classroom contributions. So, academic freedom is not a constitutional principle. It is just a policy. A cherished one, to be sure, though a limited one. It only protects professors. I'm not a professor. I could be fired tomorrow for what I say here today. Although I don't think I will be, or I would not be doing it. So my proposal is for us to be morally ambitious law school. I like us because I think we're the Avis of law schools. We try harder. We're ambitious about everything. We're ambitious to have the best faculty. We're ambitious to be the leading public service law school. We're ambitious to be the global law school. We're ambitious to be the best law school in law and business. Well, I would like us to be the best law school on equality. Free speech has a long history in our country. The First Amendment is the First Amendment. It was adopted in 1791. Equality is a much newer concept. Equal Protection Clause was not adopted until after the Civil War. Women did not receive the right to vote until 129 years after the First Amendment was adopted. Anti-discrimination laws were not passed until the 1960s. Lawrence versus Texas was not decided by the United States Supreme Court until 2003. That's the case which struck down Texas sodomy law. But we at NYU pride ourselves on our commitment to equality and our long-standing commitment to equality. Our website here says, we are one of the first law schools to admit women. NYU has been long committed to welcoming students of diverse backgrounds, people who have been discriminated against by many other institutions. So how can we reconcile and balance our institution's values of academic freedom and equality? I propose that we should not hire professors who advocate for violence against or criminalization of members of our community based on their identity. Adopting this principle as a factor in hiring, either under the collegiality or teaching prongs of our three-pronged hiring decisions, would recognize our students' rights to be taught in a non-discriminatory environment and furthers the university's mission to teach. I believe it's impossible for LGBT students and all of us who believe in human rights to learn from a professor who believes that some students in the class should be imprisoned. To try to learn in that context is akin to a hostile environment that had been found to be unlawful under Title VII and Title IX, because students do not have the choice to leave the classroom or to freely speak up. As I said before, it's not a true marketplace of ideas. I believe that my proposal would not diminish academic freedom because it only applies to advocacy of criminalization or violence and only applies to hiring. We could invite Professor Thio here to debate, but that's qualitatively differently than inviting her here to teach. My proposal accords with Dean Rivez's statement that he would hire someone to teach a death penalty course who believed in the death penalty. But it would mean that we could not hire the Ku Klux Klan to teach race and the death penalty, a course that we do offer, because the Ku Klux Klan advocates violence against our community members. At the town hall, Dean Rivez also left open the possibility that we might hire someone to teach who denies that the Holocaust occurred. My proposal would allow that, but would not allow us to hire someone who advocates that Jews should be thrown into jail for going into synagogue, or Catholics into jail for going to mass. In conclusion, I also propose that a student representative be on all of our hiring committees, including those for visiting faculty. I look forward to discussing with all of you during this forum how we might balance our institution's values of academic freedom and quality. Professor Yoshino.
I'm Kenji Yoshino, and I'd first like to thank Dean Ellis for her incredibly eloquent remarks. It's a tough act to follow, but I'll do my best. I should also say that there's a moment in To the Lighthouse where Mr. and Mrs. Ramsey are walking along together along a cliff path, and Mr. Ramsey says, "I'll be very proud of our son if he gets a fellowship," and Mrs. Ramsey says, "I'll be proud of him whether he gets a fellowship or not." And each of them keep walking along, and they know that they'll disagree about this for all time, but they're each so grateful to the other person for holding the opposite view. So I actually don't know if Professor Ellis or Dean Ellis feels this way about me, but I certainly feel this way about her.
I do feel the same way.
I'm grateful that there's a robust debate about this, because I think this is a close question. I think it's a difficult question, and I think that it's right that we actually discuss this in an open and civil format. So I obviously stand on the academic freedom side of this exchange, and I think what's important to underscore here, given that many of you, I haven't had the pleasure of meeting many of you, is that I too, in a kind of contrarian way, come to this from an odd position. In the same way that Dean Ellis is protecting the KKK's right to march in the public square, but is for equality values here, so too have I spent most of my life arguing for the equality of LGBT individuals. So most of my professional career has been devoted to LGBT rights. I co-wrote one of the amicus briefs on international law in Lawrence versus Texas, the 2003 case that overturned Bowers versus Hardwick, the case to which Dean Ellis is alluding. I've written extensively in LGBT rights, and I was one of the four lead plaintiffs in the Burt versus Rumsfeld case, which was a case that challenged the anti-gay Solomon Amendment all the way to the Supreme Court. So it's a heavy irony indeed that I find myself on the right side of this debate, and right in quotes there as opposed to correct. But I do really believe in this position, and I think that part of the courage that Professor Ellis is talking about is the courage to stand up for your beliefs, even if they are contrarian, both based on one's own personal history and in the environment in which one finds oneself. So let me begin by saying that. I think that to take up the question of whether to choose between speech and equality, I think that we do have to choose between speech and equality. Or rather, I do think that we need to make a choice here. In this case, I think we need to choose both, you know, and I'll elaborate on that more in both Q&A and in these brief opening remarks. So the first thing I want to say is that there are two visions of Dr. Thio's visit here that have been produced, and they're not mutually contradictory, but I think that it's useful to disaggregate them. One vision is that the moral principle of LGBT equality is so incontestable and so akin to our moral compunctions about discrimination based on race that she should not be allowed to enter our community. The second is that it's precisely because of a difference in the real world between the acceptability of racism and the acceptability of homophobia that we cannot allow her into our institution, because our institution has a dog in the fight through its anti-discrimination policy and through its broader social commitments to this hotly debated area. And it's precisely because it's contested that she should not be allowed to come in and hold a position that's antithetical to the institutions. So I don't think that these are inconsistent, because one pertains to the ideal world, what we wish were true in an ideal world, and one takes into account the fact of the real world being far short of what we view to be ideal. But I think under either vision, I can make the case that Dr. Thio should be able to come here and to teach her class. So let's begin with the question that I feel like has been repeatedly dodged in all of these debates, which is to say that how do you deal with the moral equivalence issue? If the institution says that there is a moral equivalence between racism and homophobia, and if we're quite sure that the institution would not invite a white supremacist or a member of the KKK to teach a class, then why is it that Dr. To gets to come to the institution? And the only explanation that seems to be readily available is to say that, in fact, the institution does not hold the same kind of commitment to combating homophobia as it does to combating racism. Now, in response to this, I want to say that I actually view this to be a very complicated issue, because I think that it has to do with generations of discrimination. So let me first say that in an ideal world and as a moral principle, I do view there to be a complete equivalence between racism and homophobia. So I'm morally categorically opposed to both of these things. However, you know, that's an ideal world argument. And once we get into the real world, we see that we're in generation one with regard to homophobia, maybe 1.5, whereas we're in generation two with regard to racism. So I think that it's actually problematic to say that we would never invite a white supremacist here to talk at the law school, rather than we would never invite somebody who is as categorically racist to come to the law school. Because I think white supremacy still exists in our society. I think that second generation white supremacy still exists in our society. And I think that we actually do debate that every day in our law school classrooms. So when we talk about reproductive justice, about who can procreate, when we talk about a criminal justice system and disparities in sentencing, when we talk about, you know, affirmative action, all these are debates about race. And ultimately, some of the individuals who take some positions in these debates are going to be expressing what I view to be white supremacist sentiments. Do I think that those debates should be cut off and that those individuals not be allowed to come and speak? No. And why is that? It's because I believe that these debates need to be had, and it's because I believe that truth ultimately prevails over error. Why would any of us even go to university if we did not think that when truth grappled with error, that truth would ultimately prevail? And so I would say, let us have that conversation, let us have that fight, and let us actually let the truth of the matter come out. With respect to anti-gay sentiment, I do feel like we're in a different place, and that, you know, in much of the world, there is great debate and contestation about whether or not LGBT individuals should have equal rights. And so I think that the concomitant responsibility there is to say that we should be having the same conversation, and it looks like we're having it a generation earlier, and that there are disparities in between the conversations we allow ourselves to have about race and that we allow ourselves to have about LGBT individuals. And there are, and I think that's appropriate, because that's where the world is. And I think that when we cut ourselves off from the rest of the world in this way, we do a great disservice, not just to ourselves, but to the broader intellectual communities in which we are part. Let me say with respect to the second point, the other vision that I want to address is a vision that the university is somehow a safe space that is different from the public marketplace. And so Dean Ellis drew a distinction in between allowing the KKK to march in the public square and allowing an individual who is a member of the KKK to teach in our classrooms, right? And she did this on both principled and on legal grounds, not to say that there's a distinction between those two. But of course, you know, as a constitutional law professor, you know, I keep trying to hammer home to my students the state action doctrine and the idea that the First Amendment doesn't apply to a private institutions such as ourselves. But I believe that the principles and the spirit of the First Amendment do. And so the question then becomes, how is the spirit of the First Amendment best defended in an institution like this? I actually do not adhere to the view that the university or the classroom is a safe space beyond a certain point. Or put differently, I might say that I believe in thinking about the classroom as a safe space, but I don't view it as a necessarily comfortable space. Right? So I believe that if Professor To came and actively harassed one of our students, as she was alleged to do in Singapore, then she would not be disqualifying. But if she's coming and saying, I believe that there is a place where human rights grounds out, and that has to do with LGBT rights, I do think that the answer to that is more speech rather than less speech. And I think that the answer to that, you know, here is in the public sphere, is more speech rather than less speech. And I might even go further. I would say, if not here, if not in the university, where are we going to have an argument for more speech rather than less speech? I do think that it's therefore incumbent on us to engage in that kind of more speech, whether or not whether she comes or not. And I think that the administration has taken a laudable stance in, you know, having this workshop series throughout this year, which I think will result in the best programming in LGBT rights issues and the most kind of momentum we've had on pro-gay issues, I believe, in the history of this institution. And in fact, that is my hope. The last thing I want to say is to think about the fact that the academic freedom principle cuts both ways, which is to say that once we start exploring the limits of this principle, there are very dangerous implications. So I want to go back in time to the 1970s and to say that the one kind of case that we were winning as LGBT individuals in the 1970s were freedom of association cases. And so there's a 1978 case that goes up to the Supreme Court on cert, which is called Rashford versus Gay Lib. The university group had tried to meet, and the university had tried to prohibit this, and the court had upheld the right to meet. And in fact, there was not a single case in which we lost the right to associate, the right to speak, and the right to express our own viewpoints. When this went up to the Supreme Court, Chief Justice Rehnquist dissented from the denial of certiorari, and he compared the congregation of people in these groups to people who had measles congregating, because he said, this isn't mere speech, this is actually the active spread of a disease. So it's comparable to measles sufferers congregating together in order to advocate against the repeal of a law banning the transmission of measles, right? And so I think that you have to see that this principle cuts both ways insofar as if we had not acquired the freedom to speak, the freedom to associate, the academic freedom in those cases, then we would not be where we are today. I'm quite confident with respect to LGBT rights. If, you know, the past is another country, then sometimes other countries resemble our past. You know, I just want to underscore here that other countries are not where we are with respect to LGBT rights. One of the huge ironies of this particular situation is that we aggressively negotiated for reciprocity with respect to academic freedom, saying that our professors, when we went over there to the National University of Singapore, would not have restrictions placed on our academic freedom. And so the question that I would leave you with is, which is a better world? Is it a better world where Professor Thio comes here and expresses her anti-gay views, and then I go to the National University of Singapore and articulate my pro-gay views? Or is it a better world in which both institutions close their gates to speakers from the other? Thank you.
Thank you. Dean Ellis, 3 minutes of rebuttal.
I believe that my proposal is still narrowly tailored enough to take account of Professor Yoshino's concerns. I agree that we need to have debates. Under my proposal, we can debate affirmative action, we can debate reproductive justice, we can debate gay marriage. But as an institution, we have said that racism and gay rights are equivalent. Dean Rivez said in his email about this situation that as an institution, we believe that a society that discriminates on the basis of sexual orientation or that tolerates such discrimination is not just. So I believe that we can have debates, but that there can be some small limitation on hiring professors to teach here who advocate for the criminalization of our students. I believe that we can have professors going back and forth who differ on many things, but to invite someone to teach in our classrooms, to teach students who have paid tuition, I'm going to speak for the moment from the perspective of a parent who works hard to save money for my kids to go to college and maybe someday to graduate school. I would feel horrible that I had struggled all those years earning money for my student, for my child to be taught in a classroom where the professor teaching them thinks they should be imprisoned. I think what I'm asking for is a very narrow exception to the free debate that we want here in this law school. My proposal does not guarantee a safe classroom. We do need to be made uncomfortable in school to rethink our assumptions. Those are all values that we all hold dear. I think my proposal is narrowly tailored to only address the most extreme circumstances where a professor is teaching students and the professor has such extreme views that those students do not have equality in the classroom. And so again, I urge us to have a conversation about whether there is a way we can reconcile both our values of free speech and our values of equality.
So, just taking up the point about the narrow tailoring exception, first of all, I want to thank Dean Ellis for actually putting a proposal on the table, because I think it's always easier to dispose and to propose. So she's actually given us a policy proposal that we can work with, and I think that that is characteristically thoughtful of her, and I appreciate that. It seems like it would be a terrible thing to be against such a proposal, but I actually find myself against it, and I will express to you why I'm against it. So I guess I just want to say one thing on that and then one additional thing and then open up that up to comments. So what I find objectionable about this proposal is, again, that it would allow other countries that allow, that have much more anti-gay sentiments to apply the same principles to bar individuals such as myself from going to those classrooms. Now that may seem counterintuitive to you, but let's say I am, as I am, on record as being a proponent of the Matthew Shepard Act, which is an anti-gay, it's a hate crimes legislation based on sexual orientation. So the idea is that if somebody is engaged in a hate crime under the Matthew Shepard Act, which is animated by sexual orientation, that the sentence of that individual should be increased and or that the act should be treated differently from a criminal perspective. And so somebody at NUS, once they learn about our policy, could easily state, and in fact, Professor Thio has stated in her book, that people want to criminalize religionists who have bona fide, good faith objections to homosexual conduct. So I want to say that if our standard is we will let you in, but the line that we draw is going to be whether or not you advocate in mere speech, right, that our students be engaged, some of your students be thrown into jail for engaging in the behavior that constitutes their identity. I would say that as a National University of Singapore, following Professor Thio's line, you could say exactly the same thing about my advocacy of thinking about violence against LGBT individuals as a hate crime, because that in essence is a different criminal offense. And I would be advocating that some of the students that I would be teaching should be thrown into jail for holding the views that they do. Now, you could actually state that, you know, obviously the obvious rebuttal to that is the conduct that defines sexual orientation is much more integral to personhood and identity than, you know, being anti-gay is to somebody's faith. But I think that that's a very slippery slope, and I don't think we want to go down that, because once we start talking about what is essential to another person's identity or not, we're in extremely troubled waters indeed. The last thing I want to say is an anecdote about the benefits of academic freedom and the reason that I don't think that they're incompatible with equality in arms. This past summer, I was invited to give a series of talks at Waseda University on constitutional law. Now, again, Japan, like many other countries in Asia, is not as, I'll just put it in absolute terms, not as evolved on LGBT rights issues as we are here in the United States. And so what happened when I went in there is that I gave a talk on constitutional law and I made some allusion to LGBT rights. And what the members of the audience were doing in solidarity was to actually have blue stars, which is an allusion to the last chapter of the book that I wrote, as their name tags in order to show solidarity. And this is actually an incredibly moving moment for me, because what I saw was that there are many, many individuals in that audience who are either gay or pro-gay and who are terrified to do anything more than to wear these name tags. But the idea was that my going there, even if I was talking about some generic issue of constitutional law, was a kind of nidus or like a focal point for them to fixate on, and it actually advanced the debate for equality in their own countries. So I think that when we're thinking about ourselves as a moral community, we have to think about ourselves not only as a community that is internal to ourselves and that's just talking amongst ourselves, but we also have to think of ourselves as a community that's sending people out into the world in the spirit of academic freedom and exchange in order to advance the values that we hold dear. So in some sense, I would argue, you know, that I'm not even against Dean Ellis with respect to ambition, because I think that my ambition for NYU is global domination with respect to both our intellectual credibility and our moral values. So I think that we have to understand that this is a principle that cuts both ways. We have to engage in more speech. We have to, you know, be stalwart in our commitment to these ideals. But the answer here is not in the classic formulation, censorship, but rather censureship. Thank you.